Dick Gregory is one of America's foremost comedians, but it would really be a grave injustice to leave his introduction with that one simple statement, because he's a complex man, a humanitarian who lectures and writes extensively in the interest of human rights and social justice. His comedy doesn't just make people laugh, it makes them think as well. Please welcome Dick Gregory. I think of myself as being a person with a pretty high energy level, but nothing compared to you. I mean, how many concert gigs did you do? How many appearances at colleges did you do last year?
I make about 310 every 10 months.
Oh, man. How do you find the energy, the strength to do it? It's incredible. You must live half your life in an airplane.
Half my life in an airplane, but I don't eat. You know, that's the, when I eat, I find out my energy.
That's logical. How did you get involved in this, in the circumstances concerning and surrounding the death of President Kennedy?
Well, I've been involved with it since the first day, accidentally. I was at home, and when the news came over the wire that President Kennedy had been shot, I thought that had we had radio and the communication system when Abraham Lincoln was shot, how valuable would tapes be, 1963 of Lincoln. So I put on all my radios, all my televisions, and start taping. About 4 hours into taping, I start hearing the same people being interviewed again, and what they said the first time had changed. And the only common denominator was that they had talked to the Secret Service. And from that point on, I was a little suspicious of what was happening. Not too much, but then when I started listening to the theories that Lee Harvey Oswald was the lone assailant, and then things start coming out that we didn't know before, that the parade route had been changed. And then when you find out that Lee Harvey Oswald, the day that President Kennedy made the announcement he was going to Dallas, and right after that, he got a job at the book depository. Now, if the parade route wasn't planned on going that way, then he had set himself up in the wrong location, or he knew something. Now, if Lee Harvey Oswald do not have the ability and the power and the rank and position to change the parade route, then who did? And from that point, I started, you know, really looking into it. I met a very brilliant gentleman in London at the time named Ralph Shunman, who had also been looking into it. And as I started meeting various people that was looking for something else, I found out that there was a whole, like, occult out here that didn't believe it. But we just kept looking and kept waiting for the press. And then when they said they would have the Warren Commission, this stopped everything, because we knew that these loose ends would be tied in, and they never were.
I want to introduce another guest we have, Robert Groden, who is celebrating his 18th birthday on the 22nd of November in 1963. He was profoundly touched by the president's death, and he desperately wanted to understand how it could have happened. For 2 years, he, like most Americans, believed in the official version, the Warren Commission version of what happened, but the day he first saw that 8mm Zapruder film, that amateur film that was made, that was the day he stopped believing. Robert, welcome, and I wish you could set up the Zapruder film a bit for us, and we'll get right into it.
Okay. Abraham Zapruder was a Dallas dress manufacturer, and it was pure accident that he brought the camera with him that day. He almost didn't. And he was looking for a good vantage point, and he picked a point on Elm Street in Dealey Plaza in downtown Dallas. As the motorcade passed in front of him, he got what is frame for frame the most valuable historical document of all time.
It's become very chic among television producers to put a disclaimer at the head of any film. The film you're about to see might be shocking, it might be horrifying, you might not want your kids to watch it. And I think the unfortunate net effect of that is to make more people watch it. Well, I'm telling you right straight out that if you are at all sensitive, if you're at all queasy, then don't watch this film. Just put on the late night movie, because this is very heavy. It's the film shot by the Dallas dress manufacturer Abraham Zapruder, and it's the execution of President Kennedy. And Bob and Dick, would you please narrate what we're seeing as we show this film?
This is commercial footage leading into Dealey Plaza. This is the car on Main Street.
So this film was taken by actual newsmen. This was spliced together with the Abraham Zapruder film.
Yes.
All right, so this is the beginning of the motorcade.
Okay, what you're seeing now is in slow motion so that you can grasp what is happening. This is a film taken by Marie Muchmore that leads into the Zapruder film. It's for time continuity. The president is waving to the crowd here.
And Jacqueline Kennedy, of course, is sitting alongside him in the open car.
Right, this is from Orville Nix's film. This is originally 8mm footage. And they're heading now toward Elm Street. They're on Houston Street now. They're going to make a left-hand turn. It's on the corner where they're going to make the turn there that the book depository was. Now, this is the Zapruder film.
Okay, so the cars are coming along now into Dealey Plaza?
Yes, these are the lead motorcycles of the motorcade.
All right, now, with the president and Mrs. Kennedy is also Governor Connally.
Right. Now, before he goes behind the sign, the president is waving to the crowd. When he comes out from behind the sign, he is shot, then Governor Connally is shot.
He's already been hit.
He's already been hit.
And now?
At the bottom of the screen, the headshot.
That's the shot that blew off his head. It's the most horrifying thing I've ever seen in the movies.
Now, the Warren Commission said that all of the shots were fired from behind by Lee Harvey Oswald, a lone assassin, firing at the president. And as you can see, clearly, the head is thrown violently backwards, completely consistent with a shot from the front, right. Now, this is an extreme blow-up of just the president from the film.
All right.
Coming out behind the sign, he's shot.
He's hit from the
front. He's hit here.
From the front, too.
From the front. Now, Jackie doesn't realize what's happened yet. She goes to his aid.
And now? He's hit
again, the violent backward motion. Totally consistent with 80% of the witnesses, which said the shot came from the grassy knoll in front and to the right.
It's interesting to note how many people is running towards where most folks thought the shots came from.
The head goes backwards in the next film from the other side of the street.
Oh, God, that's awful. That's the most upsetting thing I've ever seen. We'll talk about it in a minute. Been joined, as you can see, by a man named Ralph Schoenman. He's a writer and historian who's been studying and investigating the president's assassination for 11 or 12 years now. Ralph, I wish you could start by giving us the Warren Commission version, the official version, the version that so far has been written into the history books about what happened, and then tell us your reasons for feeling that that was not the way it really happened.
Well, Geraldo, as you know, the official view is that Lee Harvey Oswald is the lone assassin and fired all the fatal shots from behind. The film that you've just seen is the irrefutable answer to that fiction. But beyond that, the actual testimony and the exhibits of the Warren Commission are one-to-one contradiction to the official report. And that concerns all of the principals, Jack Ruby, all of the people that they interrogate. Indeed, what we find is that the common theme uniting the people in Watergate and in the Bay of Pigs operation and in Dallas, the execution of John Kennedy, is counterintelligence, the Central Intelligence Agency.
The CIA.
CIA.
All right, now I'm going to play the role of the devil's advocate here and say that we've heard all these conspiracy theories before. Be specific if you have an allegation to make and you have documentation to back it up. For instance, Harvey Oswald is generally known to have been a communist, slightly or massively, as it turns out, I guess, deranged. Do you have evidence saying that he wasn't a communist?
Lee Harvey Oswald was an agent of the Central Intelligence Agency.
Prove it.
He had been at Sugi Air Force Base in the Marines with high security clearance. Indeed, there is a Secret Service report, which the Warren Report chooses not to discuss, Secret Service Report number 767, which refers to Alan Sweat, Chief Criminal Division of the Sheriff's Office in Dallas, who discusses the FBI number of Lee Harvey Oswald, S-172, and the document makes reference to a Central Intelligence Agency number for Oswald, number 110669. Now, leaving aside the matter of the authenticity of the information in the Secret Service report, what's important is that the Warren report chooses to ignore all of the relevant evidence concerning the CIA role of Oswald. There are 51 documents pertaining to CIA intelligence and Lee Harvey Oswald, which are consigned to the National Archives, not to be opened for 75 years as of the killing of John Kennedy. The very least that must be demanded by any investigating body, and certainly the Rockefeller Commission, which is supposed to be investigating the domestic role of CIA, is to subpoena and demand those documents to be shown to the American people.
Jack Ruby is the restaurateur who killed Lee Harvey Oswald on national television.
Right.
He said, according to the summation of the Warren Commission, that he acted solely because of grief that this great man, John Kennedy, had been assassinated, and he sought to take revenge.
That's a very good example of how the Warren Report has totally fabricated the truth. The actual statements of Jack Ruby bear no relation to the Warren Report's summation of them. In volume 5 of the very exhibits and documents of the Warren Commission, we find the verbatim testimony of Jack Ruby. And in that testimony, he states that he can't tell the truth in Dallas. He wants to be taken to Washington. He says, "You'll never see me alive if you don't get me out of Dallas."
He says that to you?
Yes, he says that to Chief Justice Earl Warren and to Gerald Ford and Leon Jaworski, who were present at the time.
They were on the Warren Commission.
Ford was a member of the Warren Commission, and Leon Jaworski was one of its counsels. Now, in this discussion, Ruby at one point states, "You could say that Lee Harvey Oswald didn't shoot John Kennedy. Jack Ruby did." He says, "You'll never see me alive again if you don't get me to Dallas."
That's verbatim testimony?
This is from the testimony. It starts pages 181, goes to 212, volume 5. And that's not only the testimony contained in the exhibits of the Warren Report, but we have the testimony of the doctor of Jack Ruby, who has disclosed the documents that he had prepared about his discussions and his treatment of Ruby. And it was published in the London Sunday Times this year. And these documents are a report of a series of confidential examinations carried out on Ruby while he was in Dallas County Jail. And Ruby states categorically that he was involved in a plot to kill John Kennedy, that he shot Oswald upon receiving a phone call from Fort Worth. And he says his last words to the doctor were, I do not want to die, but I am not insane. I was framed to kill Oswald."
Now, Ruby, according again to official history, contracted a cold while in prison, and approximately 24 hours later, he died. Of lung cancer, right.
Rather an extraordinary timing, considering that he was just about to have a hearing in which his sanity at the time of the murder of Oswald was to be assessed, when Ruby would have had an opportunity in public court to advance his views as he attempted to express them to the Warren Commission.
Right. Your basic point is that the CIA is the common denominator linking all these people together.
Well, that's not a question of my point. That's what the FBI reports and the commission documents and exhibits show.
Have you told this to anyone? Official power position.
For starters, I told this to Charles Olson, an investigator for the Rockefeller Commission.
The commission investigating the CIA?
Yes, the official commission, from which we do not expect great things, but we do intend to embarrass them with the facts, and of course to present this data both to congressional committees and across the United States, to college audiences and to the public as best we can. The Central Intelligence Agency, particularly counterintelligence, constantly appears in the lives of these disparate people. They're all connected to it. For example, when James Angleton resigned as head of counterintelligence on Christmas Day, he made the rather extraordinary statement quoted in the New York Times on December 25th. He said, "There were many rooms in the mansion. I wasn't privy to who struck John." Well, I think we ought to know who he thinks was privy to who struck John.
Thank you. It's very unsettling. Thank you for being on the show. I might say, just as an addendum, that we tried to get a spokesman from the Rockefeller Commission to come on the program. They said it was not propitious to comment at this time. We'll be right back.
Aren't you frightened sometimes that someone's going to try and hurt you?
No, I tell you, I have a wife and 10 kids, and if something happened to all of us, America's bigger than we are. And if the assassination of President Kennedy is reopened and the truth is found out, my family and myself is very insignificant. What scares me the most is the amount of decent American people who have called me, sent me letters, who meet me in airports and say, "Wow, I heard about what you're into, they're gonna kill you." The fact that we live in a free democratic society and our super subconscious, we admit that there is an organization that will kill you. And I would say that I'm outraged, not at the CIA, not at the murderers. I'm outraged over the fact that the American press should be doing what we are doing today. There are thousands of researchers that have as much, if not more, than what you heard us say. We were just fortunate enough to wiggle it through and slip it to the American people. And I would like to see the American press, even the press that say everything we have is not true, to come out and do the research and let the American people know, was it a trick, was it a conspiracy, and let's open up the Warren Report. Let's talk about a new investigation for the 200th anniversary of America. And if we don't, I think this country's gonna be in a lot of trouble.
Right. When I had finished reading through the recent news stories on the renewed interest in the assassination of President Kennedy, because there is real renewed interest, my first response was to ask if there was any new evidence that either a conspiracy existed or, more generally, that Lee Harvey Oswald wasn't acting alone on that November day in 1963 when President Kennedy was killed and the new frontier was closed. My reaction now, after listening to Dick and to Bob and to Ralph and seeing that incredible and very horrifying film, is to ask what's wrong with the old evidence. The official explanation of the Warren Commission that Oswald was acting alone is just so difficult to reconcile with the evidence that exists today. Now, if you can remember back and be honest to when all these theories about conspiracies first came out in the mid-60s, then we treated the researchers and the people doing this investigation as kind of paranoid kooks. I mean, let's be honest, that's the way it was. But now we've all lived through the Pentagon Papers, Watergate, dirty tricks, and even the allegations, and I stress the point that they're only allegations, that the CIA and the FBI, institutions that are so solid in American history and the fabric of American society, have engaged in illegal operations against American citizens. Well, because of all that, I think that most people are now more willing to listen to opposing points of view. I think one thing is certain. There are just too many loose ends. John Kennedy was murdered, and we at least owe him the duty of doing everything possible to find out who all was involved. Now, possibly, just possibly, the Warren Commission was right, and it was just the act of a single madman, however unlikely that seems now. But what if it wasn't? With the perspective of more than 11 years of history between then and now, an intensive official investigation could and should be launched. Even if there's just one chance in 1,000, or even one chance in 1,000,000, that the assassination was more than we were told it was. That's it. That's it for now. Dick, thank you very much for being with us. Thank all of you all for being here and for watching. I want to thank Raquel and all the guests that we've had tonight. The next edition of Good Night America is on the 27th of March. Until then, peace and good night, America.
Arlen Specter, former assistant counsel to the Warren Commission, will be a guest on the next edition of Good Night America, and will comment on the film and the assassination of President Kennedy that you've just seen.
Gone 500 miles and the day is done.